anyone from the audience want to add more of their war stories and learnings, we'd be happy to hear that.
I have a funny one, but why don't you go ahead and share yours? I'll share mine after that.
So mine was like, it's a B2B app. That means like we're sitting in Bangalore. Most of the customers are sitting in the East Coast or West Coast of US. So it just becomes very normal that whenever you add a new feature, you need to add a database migration. That is like you are using Python Django at the time. That means like we had Django migration. So the idea was like first you had the migration to the table with all null values. So application does not know any of these thing that is there is new column. So your APIs work as smooth and there is nothing breaks in the product. But this was a assumption everybody was working. But what happened is one time we had to make a migration and it is like afternoon India time, there's no customer. But unfortunately, what happened is some programmer or some organization, a programmer figured out a way we have an API and he figured out there's an API key. And he has done a scheduled job, I think like midday 2 a.m. or to upload some details. As a result, what happened, like we were running the migration, suddenly the migration script stuck because there are a lot of table locks. We were figuring out where is this table locks coming and we figured out there is one particular client connection is hanging through and we cannot abort the transaction because we did not have what is a rollback plan. Because for us, like migration will normally go through in 2 to 3 minutes, so we don't have to worry. But this person was like uploading like say like almost like a lot of media files. It was going on for 10, 15 minutes. And the DB state was like stuck and we can see like it became like a one kind of an outage issue because new updates were not going through and a lot of 500 errors were happening. And we have to kill the connection and reset the migration. And that is how we fixed that. It was not something really good, but that's we learned a very hard way. Swanand, do you want to go?
Okay, cool. Yeah. The reason why this story is very funny is because I caused it. And the reason I learned a bunch of things from this is because we were smart enough to design the database in a way that it did not do lasting damage. And so two lessons to learn from this story. So context, in my previous company, we had this concept of seller scores, where there was an app and there's a whole bunch of things. Let me give you quick in context on what the app was. The app was used by real estate agents and they would have different actions about the contacts that they've uploaded. You can think of it like a Tinder for real estate agents, where they would do left swipe, right swipe on their contacts based on a score. And this score was like a likelihood of this contact buying the house in the next 1 year. And we had like routine deployments. We would constantly refine the algorithm that would generate the score. We had data scientists working round the clock, improving our model. And on one, I think it was in July or something, we realized that the last time we did the algorithm deploy, something was not quite correct. And the scores were not right. All the scores created after a particular date, they were incorrect. And so a lot of realtors were getting incorrect matches or they were getting irrelevant results. And so we figured, okay, you know what? This is a generated column or generated data. Let's just wipe it and we'll regenerate the scores for September. And there was a lot of debugging and last minute panic debugging that went on before we settled on this, before we realized that this is what is happening. But when we figured out that this was the problem, I said, okay, fine, you know what? It's pretty straightforward. We'll write a bad job to delete all the scores from September. Then we'll run the ETL job and it'll regenerate the scores. In the meantime, the data scientist folks, they'll fix the algorithm. And within a couple of hours, it should be okay. Our the ETL pipeline was Spark based and it used to take about an hour or two to run. And things were looking okay. And so I went, I wrote up the query and I ran it. And suddenly realized every single score from the database had vanished. And we were getting 10 times more complaints. And I couldn't figure out what is going on. We had double checked everything. The query was okay. Everything seemed okay, but we couldn't figure out why the data was missing. And again, this was nighttime India, like 2 a.m. or something for me. And my pair, my manager on the other side, it was daytime for him. And both of us had double checked and we couldn't figure out what the problem was. And it turns out it was a copy paste. I was copying queries written from Vim and pasting on a Rails console and pasting them and executing them or in a PSQL console. And the query that read something like delete from seller scores where date greater than foo, the where date greater than foo was never copied. And only delete from seller scores was copied. And without a where clause, a delete query just deletes everything. when we realized it turned out that in the copy paste, there was like a new line character, which is not considered as like the same line. And then the where part was treated as like a different line. And so console waits for a new line character to execute the your statement, right? And so the moment it saw the new line character, it just ended up executing the query and we ended up wiping the table. So the lesson learned was this, that never copy paste, always have stored procedures or the tasks or predefined tasks to change data. And the reason we did not do lasting damage or we did not have to resort to backups is because the schema was very nicely designed. All the data that we lost, or supposedly lost, was completely generative data that we could have, there was no transactional data. And that was the thing, like sometimes you make mistakes, but if your schema design, if your data design is robust, then you can limit the damage of your mistakes. Like for example, if you have transactional data, then you have to handle that differently. Or if you have irrecoverable data, then you handle that differently versus if you have generated data, then you handle that differently. And then, so that's it. That's the lesson.
Thanks, Swanand. Anyone else? Navroon? Oh, Prathamesh is here. Prathamesh, you have a SQL war story.
Not really a war story, but like mostly we have a lot of time series data. And we have to manage the we have to manage the age of the data very diligently. Otherwise, the database sort of keeps increasing a lot. And I don't have any war story as such as of now. Just that you have to be very diligent about the queries, indexes, so that the model or the schema that you are designed for actually caters for all the use cases.
So how often do you delete the data or do you just archive the data?
So we have a rolling mechanism. Any data that is beyond last 28 days, that automatically, so we use Timescale DB for our time series database extension. And anything beyond the 28 days, it just gets rolled over and gets automatically deleted. For any fresh data, we use different tables for archived data as well as fresh data. So that is one strategy that has helped us in terms of showing the most recent data and then showing last 7 days data, 14 days data, last month's data. The queries for month's data are a bit slower compared to the fresh data, but the expectation of the users also in that case is that the data will come a bit slowly because it's a month's data or 2 weeks data. So that is manageable. And then using Timescale DB, basically because of the compression algorithm that Timescale DB has, managing the queries is very easy. Another advantage is that you can use it with any normal PostgreSQL table as well. You don't have to have everything as a hyper table or the general Timescale DB nomenclature that is there. You can actually make joins between a normal PostgreSQL table as well as a Timescale DB table. So that works out pretty well. The disadvantage there is that because it's a hyper table, you cannot really change it. Once it is set in stone, it is set in stone. You have to drop the table and recreate it if you want to change any schema. But we have done that 2-3 times. So that is no longer a problem. Like we have basically dropped a used table and then recreated it again from the backup or restore mechanism. But the main advantage there is that basically you can just write the queries in raw SQL, pure SQL. There is no different syntax or language that you have to learn. It is just PostgreSQL syntax, and you can just make it work with any framework or any other library that you use for your web development.
Thanks, Prathamesh. Anyone else want to share any of their stories?
Yeah, I have one. So this is less of a war story, and this is, I don't know how to categorize it. It just didn't go well for us. So what happened is, by the time I joined my organization, we had already a migration from Mongo to Postgres underway. And so like, why the migration was started and how it would go was not really planned. And we were, so what we decided was we would move some of the regions to Mongo and some of the regions to Postgres. And we ended up with our app running both on Mongo and Postgres at the same time. And then at one point we just realized we couldn't continue doing this. So we just decided that we'll carry out the whole migration. And the migration did not go smoothly, and we lost a customer. After that, everything was put on hold. We were planning on maybe rolling back everything back to Mongo, and we stopped all development at that point, all feature development. And then we probably spent 2 months figuring out the migration, and the migration went through completely. After 2 months, we moved completely to Postgres. So yeah, so my war story would be, please plan out your stuff, else you'd be caught in our situation.